Russell, maybe we can just start with the injuries. Which of those players are going to be back before the Ireland test? And maybe if you can just run through them for us.
Yeah, sure. Hello, everybody. So Stephen Kitzer will be out. John Clend will be out. Lurie Jager will be out. Jael de Pre will be out. Jaden. Henko, which we had in camp, Kanan, Damien, and Kirtley. Those will be the guys who's not available.
Is that just for Wales now?
First Ireland test match also.
Okay.
Hi, Rassie. Hi. If the Bulls lose on Saturday,
yeah.
Could they be included in the Wales team, or is it too late for that ship to sail?
No, I think in certain positions, yes, definitely. If you look at the squad that we have here currently, we're going to hopefully announce our team internally on Sunday. So the guys can, from Monday, especially the newer guys in the team, get settled before we fly out Wednesday. So in certain positions, we will be a few young guys next to each other. You know, then some of the Bulls guys... which we know, understand how we want to play and change a few things. Some of them has been, most of them has been at alignment camps. So I don't think everybody that will eventually be involved with the Irish test matches will get drafted in for the Welsh test match just for the pure fact that they haven't really trained with us apart from next week. So, but then where there's a hell of a lot of experience. And, we've got already a few injuries on the outside backs, on the wingers. Cheslin is touch and go to be ready then. But my Pimpy is fine. And, we might be thin there, but then we've got Owen and we've got Fassie. But a guy like Willy LaRue might be somebody who can just help settle down the combinations there. Depending on how the guys do tomorrow and injury-wise. But, it wouldn't be ideal for them just to have trained three training sessions and play a test match against Wales.
Russell, just on that, how important will it be for South African rugby that the Bulls are putting a strong performance against Leinster on Saturday?
No, very important. I mean... as much as I would love to have them in our camp and be with us every single minute since last week, since Monday, and the alignment camps and everything. Leinster is, I think everybody's, all countries are striving to have a franchise like Leinster. I mean, they do sometimes lose big matches, but they're consistently, in the top four, in the final or host the final, and obviously that gets transferred into the national team. So, for us, if the Bulls can pull this one through, I think it's going to be really, really tough. If the Bulls can pull it through, we're fully behind them. And if it means we have to play without the Bulls players, but the South African franchise goes through, I think that's very important and will boost us overall to eventually get Champion Cups victories and so on. I think the URC is another step. It's not only the Stormers, vitally important.
Russell, in terms of your selection policy, for Wales, is it kind of a balance between holding guys back for Ireland, keeping guys in cotton wool, giving newcomers a chance, or how do you look at it?
Yeah, I think we're at a stage where we don't have the luxury of keeping guys in cotton wool. Simple thing is a guy like, if you just take a Ox, has played a lot, but, he's not tired. He's not punch drunk. Same with Vincent. Same with France. Kalek Gerritsen did really well for us last year. When he comes available, he'll probably be someone who just slots in. He's not old and punch drunk, So then a guy like Malcolm is somebody you probably want to manage a little bit. And with the other hookers around, you have to think carefully because you want to see some new blood playing. But then also you don't want to happen what happened in 2018 where, we blooded a hell of a lot of guys, but we lost the test match. So we want to win the test match. We want to manage some guys getting back from injury, and then we also want to try and get some youngsters through. So it is a bit of a, I won't say a balancing act, but as the weeks go on, we get clarity. Okay, Malcolm can play in that game. Okay, Cheslin, we have to manage him still. Kirtley is still out. As the weeks go on. But I think putting them in cotton will... they won't be then match fitness and almost battle ready for Ireland, you know. And Wales is certainly no pushover as we've always experienced.
Russell, just following up on that, looking back in hindsight, the decision in that 2018 game against Wales to blood a lot of people, looking back in hindsight, do you think it was worth it, even though you lost, or would you rather have actually just won that test and maybe fielded a stronger team?
I think twice against Wales, was it, that we picked. Didn't we Wales the other year also in the second test match pick a totally different team? We lost that match, but then I certainly think it paid off for some guys who made the step up from maybe playing a tier 2 team, playing a tier 1 team, then playing maybe the All Blacks or teams who's number 1 and 2 in the world. But also, you know, we all understand that losing a test match, obviously there comes negativity, there comes a bit of worry with that, there comes a bit of pressure with that. So without a doubt, you know, we have to keep our long-term hat on. But as we all know, as South Africans, for ourselves, our players and our management, you don't want to make it easy. Those guys must still be able to win that test match. I think that's the most important thing.
Russell, in terms of those youngsters, you've brought in quite 11 uncapped players. Mm. That's quite a nice, big, exciting group, getting a lot of experience now, you know, going into this Worlds game. But also there are a few guys that must help, you know, guys like Solomon Hartenberg down in Western Cape, Sinelo Nahamba, I think even Warwick Land, you know. Would those guys come in to the possible squad after the Wales test, or do you think you'll be more bringing in more experienced guys to bolster ahead of Ireland?
Yeah, you look. Remember when we played Faf at 9 and 10 at the World Cup? You know, there's always and fully understand it that there's question marks around that. You know, and we know Faf can do what Sanelle do at 9 and 10 because we've been seeing him at training sessions, seeing him play for Sale Sharks there, and I mean he played for us in the World Cup. So, yeah, we've got so many great scrum offs, and I actually think with Jaden being injured now, Kobus Reinach is playing really, really well for Montpellier as well. We've got 4 or 5 flyoffs now here currently. And it depends, you know, if things go well, then one can, not that I say Portugal will be easy in Bloemfontein, we'll see what they did to Fiji. So, but we'll certainly pick our games where we blood some youngsters, and for me, Sanele is almost not a youngster. He's a guy that's been around the block. Him and Jaden was together in the junior Springboks. He can play 9 and 10 now. So he's definitely somebody that's versatile, and one or two injuries and a guy like him might be pulled up. But yes, I can't say now what we're already going to do because I'm not quite sure. We first must see how does the guys go against Wales? Did we build momentum? Are we going in the right direction? Then it's a home series against Ireland, which win is paramount, like all test matches. And then a Portugal test match become, are the squeeze on us, or are we a bit out of the pressure zone, if I can call it that way? And that will certainly have an influence on our selection.
Russell, just you picked 3 locks. Eric is obviously going to become available at some point, but Duit and Jong, are you maybe a bit thin there, or have you got other plans for them in general?
No, we are a bit thin, but you know, Salman has been pushing really hard always. Again, a guy who's coming from a junior Boca, being captain there, and always when it's his turn, it's just a bad injury, you know. So he would have been a real contender going to the World Cup last year, but then he got that long-term injury. He's looking really good, typical front lock type of, and with him and Ergie and Eamon being solid front locks, and we know Sos can call, and Ergie can also call at 5, which he did. Definitely, one or two of the Bulls guys would be lovely to see how it goes this weekend against Leinster, who forms a big part of the Irish team, and that might definitely sway us in that direction. And then obviously you've got Peter Sefzatua, who can easily slot in for you at the 5 lock and can call the lineouts. But I agree with you. I remember when it was Jean playing Ergia, Luat, all of those guys last year, just being in the huddle. The huddle was much taller than it's currently. So, but we're looking at that.
Russell,
coach, with all of these new players coming in, them, 12 of them, what for them to have a long-term future in the Springboks, what do you want from them? What are you expecting from them? And what are you looking at specifically to for them to stay on the team?
Yeah,
for Ireland and
Rugby
Championship.
Yeah, everyone is different, you know. A guy like Edwell, for example, now with the way he's training and the way he's putting up his hand, and the moment if he'll start feeling comfortable and safe in the environment and can be himself and within our systems, you know, do things that other players can't do. Like Cheslin, we pulled him in cold 5 days before New Zealand test match, and he just slotted in. These boys have now a chance to have been at alignment camps, virtual, in person at Cape Town, and now having a full camp week and next week a test match week. You know, it's all about how quickly they understand, how quickly they don't have to think too much. Things come naturally, so that the reason why we pick them is they've got something about them, and that what we see, or which is different from other players, which we did not pick, that we want to see come through. Whilst feeling settled and being themselves in the environment, and that's also up to our coaches to help them to bring to the party what they have, and that's what I hope to see.
This is maybe a follow-up on what Morgan asked, looking ahead at the Portugal test, which is still far away.
Yeah.
But how would you approach a test like that with a second-tier team, if you want to call it that? Do you want to lead the youngsters there? Would it be a mix of experience with these youngsters? How would you approach that?
I'm trying to say it in better words. You know, I think it all goes with momentum. When we... The previous times, remember we didn't have 2020s to build after 2019. But then we did have the next year. But it was the Lions series as well. But if the momentum is going with you and everybody's positive, and I can almost say the vibe around the Springboks from you guys, from the supporters within the camp, then it's easy to make some changes, and it's always a positive thing. So the first thing is, you know, if this Wales test match goes well, one can say, okay, 6 or 5 of the guys made it really, and we've got them as bankers. And some of them might play themselves into the Irish series, because some boys are not available yet, like the guys who play in the Premiership and in France, and then obviously the Bulls are not available currently. So, yes, if everything goes to plan, not because we don't rate Portugal, but because we've got momentum and things goes well, then it's a good game to, I wouldn't say just throw in a lot of youngsters in there. I think still you'll have to have a good spine in there that helps those youngsters. But some of them might get experience now against Wales already. So I hope it makes sense. It's just how the momentum goes at that stage.
Of course, just looking at your hooker situation, it seems like it's a healthy situation to have, especially when you have a player like Malcolm Marks coming back. But you also might want to give a player like Andrew Hooper Fent an opportunity in the Green Group. How do you balance that between maybe giving an opportunity and also giving rugby to the legs of Marks, who hasn't played rugby since the injury in France?
Yeah, I see the big thing is they train against each other, and sometimes our scrum sessions and mauling sessions and line-out sessions, we sometimes put each other under more pressure than we sometimes experience in games. So having them in training camp now, scrumming against Joseph, scrumming against Bongi, feeling Ox on this side, you know, feeling France on that side, you learn a lot, and you see a lot of the guys. So again, a guy like Grobis, you know, he's been doing really, really well for the Bulls. You know, we even had Marco van Staden in the last two games of the World Cup, who helped us out there. Who I really think it's somebody, you know, where we can take sometimes a chance if we pick squads, because he really can fit in both those roles. But then again, there's a guy like Vessels from the Bulls, who now is a very versatile prop and hooker, which bodes well for the future. When you look to 2027, I mean, there's certainly the names you mentioned, Andre Gouventer, Vessels, Grobbies, and a guy like Malcolm and those guys. So where we were really thin last year when we got in that final game against at the World Cup. It looks pretty okay now.
Russ, just in terms of the captaincy, obviously no CF next week, whether that is going to be captaining for, but after you name that squad for Ireland, will you make an announcement on who's going to be the long-term captain or kind of go game by game?
No, we will announce captain. This week it will be probably be, to be honest with you, inside the team, the captaincy is not such a big thing. Obviously, long-term permanent captain is something. But when we go into this World Test match without Sia, and without seeing if Sia comes without an injury back to South Africa, and we can assess him and see how he slots in and those kind of things. We have 2 weeks after the World Test match. But yeah, it will probably be Peter Steftetoy or Eben. It can be Bongi, you know, but then you might want to start Malcolm to manage his game time so that, you know, if Bongi goes down in 10 minutes, Malcolm doesn't have to play a full 70 or something like that. So, I must be say the guys are leading really well. The core of the group that's been with us for 4 years, they understand that there's youngsters around them. Everybody's coaching with us and helping with us. So we'll make that call on Sunday night after the Bulls game internally. And yeah, we'll announce a captain for Wales. But then when we announce the Irish squad after that, you know, obviously we'll announce. And obviously a guy like Sia will be in the running if everything goes really well and he's injury free and those kind of things.
That was my question.
Coach, just a question around the fact that a lot of teams were benchmarking against the Bucks when they played this year.
Yeah.
Just to check where they are. How much pressure does it put on you to sort of like innovate the style of play, considering the fact that they know our strengths?
Yeah, look, luckily, I don't think people can keep beating that drum, you know, because prior to 2019, everybody said nobody gave us a chance. And then prior to 2023, everybody said now the pressure is on you. So I think we kind of used to that kind of pressure. Not that it makes anything easier. But the reality is, you know, this is our reality. We know how hard we work and how hard we train and what we can do and what the potential of the players are, what the talent is, how we operate from within. So we can't control how motivated those guys are on that side. You know, we can only control how focused, how ready. I guess that's one of the challenges. But it certainly makes the guys more edgy, more determined, because that's what will happen with the teams play against us. And even a team like Portugal, when I say even, it sounds like one almost want to say, obviously a tier two team, but beating Fiji is not a fluke, you know. It doesn't happen if there is not a lot of good players in that team. And knowing my Portuguese friends in Bloemfontein, there will be a lot of support there for them.
Coach, just to take us through the new relationships that you've had to build within your own coaching staff, you know, Tony Brown there. What are they bringing to the party that's different? How is it going to change the approach? And has it already changed the approach of you guys coaching and the way you guys are possibly going to play?
Yeah, it's interesting when people ask us about chasing the sun too, you know, are we giving too much away? Are we not giving too much away? Are we giving too much access or not? I think if you go and watch Chasing the Sun, you must know all the things that you showed there will definitely change. And the things that we didn't show will probably stay the same. I know Tony for a really long time. I coached him at the Stormers. I know he's the kind of guy that, and he did slot in really quickly. He played for the Sharks and for the Stormers. He knows South Africa. He knows how we think. You all saw what a guy like Felix did. And I mean, Felix, when I went to Munster, went straight from breaking his neck to being my assistant coach at Munster. I picked him, it was his first coaching gig. And when you see what a guy like that has, he's now got 2 World Cup titles. Now, Tony has experience that not a lot of guys have. And in a country, in Japan, obviously, but also in New Zealand, who's still one of the top-ranked teams consistently. So he brings a lot of excitement, knowledge, and I think definitely opens some of our backline players' eyes and opportunities and utilizing opportunities. And then Jerry, again, I coach with him and Felix at Munster. You know, he's a typical like Felix are. You know, hours and hours behind the computer, just like Jacques were. Very much the same mold. But again, one or two things that's exciting about what he can bring to our defense system. The challenge is always, how quickly can we bring all of those things together to work in a big test match? But very excited about those two. Also, Barry, who was the other analyst in France, who helped us out. Now he'll be with us from next week. He definitely also bring another dimension with Lindsay, who is our current analyst. And then Jakob Paper. I think having Pipes there for every training session, every scrum session, any line-out session, we're almost used to having a referee here, who's last year could have still refereed the World Cup final. So I think the new people in the management team is definitely contributing in the way we wanted to.
Rassie, I know you weren't selecting for a tournament like you were for the World Cup.
Yeah.
You took one recognized flyer to the World Cup and you got five in this one. What's the thinking behind having that many? That's the first part. And then the second part is, was someone like Siya Masuku as much of a sort of ball from the blue as it seemed to be for most of the rugby public?
Yeah, look, to the World Cup, you want to go and win the tournament. That's why, you know, we can go with two and hopefully Andre gets ready, and we always know there will be injury. I've never been to a World Cup where there hasn't been injury, and we always said if there was an injury apart from the front row, and by that I included the hooker, but then unfortunately Malcolm got injured, but we needed Andre in that World Cup. A tournament like that, you're there. It doesn't help you have five fly-offs there. Of course, only three can really play. You can only have three in a match at 23, where you can have a lot of nines. Of course, it makes training more effective, and it's more effective and productive your training sessions. Now, building towards 2027, we still have the luxury of have Andre here. You know, Gaza is injured, Damien is injured. But now's the time to get the youngsters in. I know Sia's not that young, but Jordan and the other guys who's involved. That's why they are pulled in now. Because in a World Cup year, it just doesn't make sense to try a few fly-offs then if you can try them now in the next 2-3 years.
Chess is obviously, because it falls out the international window, very difficult in terms of logistics, player availability with our big European contingent, ball still being in the URC. But is it still a really nice experience for you guys? And is it something that you'll look to do, keep doing in the future, you know, maybe having one outside of the window where you can have more of the youngsters and more of a very core South African group involved and at a neutral venue, you know, against teams? Is it something you guys quite enjoy?
Yeah, we do. Look, at the end of the day, when the result is out, it was a test match. And like, we won't have a couple of our players available for this match. I think the Wilds also has 6 or 7 players that won't be available that plays in the Premiership. So, yes, sometimes you get to this 2 weeks out from this test match and you think, maybe the Stormers go through, and the Lions go through, and the Bulls go through, and then you said, "Well, we'll have a squad for that." And but then when you start dotting down the names, we just see that the depth that we do have in South Africa. There's really a couple of players who could have been here, and so we like this test match. It's a full-on test match, but even if the Stormers and the Bulls and the Lions were out, I think we still would have been able to put 25 or 28 players on that plane, because some players are just not picked because we can't train with 40 players, you know. But they're really, really good, and they're one injury away or one good performance away from making the squad.
Guys, we've got 5 minutes left, so if there's Afrikaans, we need to get it in now. If there isn't, then Stan, you can fire away. Afrikaans, we've got 5 minutes left. If you need Afrikaans, get it now, please, guys.
Rassie, just in Afrikaans, your sort of objectives for
for the upcoming season as well? So what do you want to see?
Afrikaans, ja. Nee, ons wil graag wen, natuurlijk elke keer is ons, ons wil momentum bou. Ek dink, waar Jockey span laas jaar opgehou het met die wereldbeker, ek dink, was hy een verloor, of twee verloor. So ek dink, ons is op een goeie plek, maar altyd na wereldbeker, wil ou die volgende jaar, ons wil soort van een, kickstart hê, runstart hê, en ons het dit gehad in 2020 met COVID, en hierdie jaar hoop ons regtig dat ons kan ons game kan develop, want in 2021 was die Leeu's hier, so en toe sit weer cutthroat, jy met die Leeu's toe trek wen, so bly maar baie binne jou boksie en try doen wat werk vir jou en wat jy weet wat werk vir jou. So, ons sal graag klein goedjies wat ons dink ons kan beter doen en dan is daar 'n paar groot veranderinge wat ons ook wil maak. So, hopelik die alignment kampe wat ons gehad het en die fisiese kamp nou in die toetsweek volgende week, sien ons van die goed wat ons regtig hard aan gewerk het, deurkom en sien ons van die nuwe spelers en die ou spelers, hoe vinnig hulle daarby kan aanpas en ook hulle eie X-factor of wat hulle ook al gekies het op, kan wys in die toetsie en alles.
Rassie, hoe goede terugslag is dit om in die oog op die eerste toetsreeks vir Currie te verloor en ook in die eerste toets nie vir Jason Colby te kan kies?
Man, Kane en Moody is ook nog daar so as jy om wil tel en ek dink as jy weer aan die ander kant toe kyk en jy sê jy sluit maar hier is maar Pimpie, you know. En as ek sien hoe Ed wil oefen en jy dink jy sluit Vassie kan ook nog vir jou wing speel en jy sien maar Jesse dalk baie vir ons wing gespeel, dan maak dit jou so half gerus, want ek dink jy ons kon in 'n erger posisie gewees het om in dieselfde posisie 'n beserings te kry nie, maar ons is nog steeds oké. Okay. En dit laat ons half gerus voel as jy ook kyk na 25, 26 en 27. So, natuurlijk is daar nog twee seer kry, dan sal ou ander planne moet maak, en selfs nou van die junior bokke moet kry, wat regtig hulle hand opsteek. En dan is daar 'n paar manne wat wel so ongelukkig was, om nie ingetrek te word nie. So, dis hoekom ek sê, ek dink ons diepte is regtig goed. En, weet, as jy boel saterdag ten lens te perform, wie ook al vir hulle wing speel, en wie ook al vir hulle fullback speel, en dan beteken dit, daar is iets rechts daar so, dan kunnen ons naar die man ook kyk. So, aan die ene kant bykie nervous, maar aan die andere kant so halve gerustheid vir die volgende stretch, as ek het so kan.
Dis is so, ja. I hate to be the one to point it out, but you and Shark are in the same city at the same time. Has there been a quiet conversation about maybe what he may or may not have learnt in Ireland?
No, I will never do that to him. We are planning to try and with the whole coaching team and our coaching team. It's not a, how can I say, not a, they're playing against the Bulls, you know. So we'll try and catch up and gonna have supper or BO2. But that will really be to catch up, you know. He's with his coaches and we with our coaches and he's coaching Leinster now. And, you know, they will never be in our lives taking a chance like that, him losing the trust that the Leinster guys have in him. We will never put him in that position and the same the other side around. But, you know, always a close friend, for sure.
Rassie, just in Afrikaans, of the Captain's Cup for Wallace and for Ireland?
Ja, die kapteinskap teen Wallis, ons sal seker Sondag intern, wat het sal iemand soos Bongie of Pieter Steef of Ewen wees. Weer eens, ons kyk maar net hoe gaan vandagse oefening nou goed gaan, niks beserings kry nie. As morgen se oefening goed gaan, niks beserings nie. Dan kan ons Sondag aankondig ja, intern, maar het sal seker Bongie of Pieter Steef of Ewen wees, een van die drie. Partykeer sien nou so toets ook as 'n geleentheid om die obvious ene seker Eben of omdat Bongie en Malcolm miskien helfte-helfte gaan speel. Maar ander kere is Pieter Steef, a game soos dit, ook gee hom weer 'n nuwe experience, iets wat hy vorentoe kan dra en vorentoe kan uitkom in sy game, want ek dink hy is amper nou die ultimate 7 for long wat jy wil hê in die span en as jy miskien